يا سيدي ويا مولاي يا رسول الله وعلى أهل بيتك المعصومين الأبرار الميامين المظلومين المضطهدين السلام عليك وعلى بضعتك المعصومة الصديقة الطاهرة التقية النقية فاطمة لعن الله الظالمين لكم من الأولين والآخرين ما خاب والله من تمسك بكم وأمن من لجأ والتجأ إليكم يا ليتنا فيا ليتنا كنا معكم سادتي فنفوز والله فوزا عظيما بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ثم أنزل عليكم من بعد الغم أمنة نعاسا يغشى طائفة منكم وطائفة قد أهمتهم أنفسهم يظنون بالله غير الحق ظن الجاهلية يقولون هل لنا من الأمر من شيء قل إن الأمر كله لله يخفون في أنفسهم ما لا يبدون لك يقولون لو كان لنا من الأمر شيء ما قتلنا هاهنا قل لو كنتم في بيوتكم لبرز الذين كتب عليهم القتل إلى مضاجعهم وليبتلي الله ما في صدوركم وليمحص ما في قلوبكم والله عليم بذات الصدور آمنا بالله صدق الله العلي العظيم. In the early years of Islam, after the migration of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam from Mecca to Medina, we know that the first battle that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam fought with the Muslims against the pagans of Quraysh, we know that although the odds were against the Muslims, their numbers were vastly smaller than the number of Qurayshi pagans who were meeting them on the battlefield, we know that from the help and the nusra and the support of Allah that the Muslim army was able to overcome the army of Kuffar. And that this victory that they achieved on the battlefield of Badr gave Muslims this fledgling nation, these new members of this religion, of the nation of Islam, gave them great confidence, gave them strength, gave them resolve. Yet you see, some years later, when the Kuffar of Quraysh rode back out against the Muslims of Medina, seeking in some part revenge for what had happened in the Battle of Badr and the losses that they had incurred on those days, we know that in the Battle of Uhud, the result was not the same. We know that the men who were standing as archers on the mountainside disobeyed the command of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that they should remain on the side of the hill, on the mountainside, and not descend down from the mountain under any circumstance until he commanded them to come down. And in fact, you know that when they saw the army of the kuffar, of the pagans of Quraysh, being routed by the Muslims, out of greed for the war spoils, for the booty that was being left behind by the pagan soldiers, they descended down the mountain, disobeying the command of Rasulullah. And when they came down into the valley from the other side, Khalid ibn al-Walid brought the other contingent of the Qurayshi army to surround them. And this created a great devastating loss upon the Muslims. Not only did it create a loss, but the Holy Quran describes that amongst the Muslims in those days, there were some believers who Allah instilled tranquility in them in the moments of grief, in the moments of anxiety, in the moments of despair. And yet there were others amongst the Muslims, Muslim by name, who the Holy Quran, he says, وَطَائِفَةٌ قَدْ أَهَمَّتْهُمْ أَنفُسُهُمْ. There were some amongst the Muslims who only they thought about the gain for themselves, their own personal gain. And these individuals, Allah says in the Holy Quran about them, يَظُنُّونَ بِاللَّهِ غَيْرَ الْحَقْ ظَنَّ الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ. They had a conception about God that was not correct. These Muslims who disobeyed Rasulullah, who were inflicted with the loss and the pain and the defeat at the Battle of Uhud, had a conception of God that was ignorant, that was not true in its understanding of what God is to a believer, what God is to a servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what did they say? They said, well, if everything truly was in the hands of God, if everything truly was in the hands of God, then why is it that we lost today? They questioned the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They questioned what had happened on the battlefield of Uhud. And yet Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, he says that in answer to your doubt about God, that in fact, this defeat is not because God willed you to lose necessarily. It is because your faith wasn't strong enough. Your faith wasn't deep enough. Your conviction wasn't resolved enough to stay on the path, to choose what God has chosen for you. And that's why Rasulullah was instructed to tell them that لو كنتم في بيوتكم لبرز الذين كتب عليهم القاتل إلى مضاجعهم. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even if you had stayed in your homes and not come out to the battlefield, those who were standing by Allah's side and by the side of Rasulullah, they would have come out and they would have met their fate defending the religion of Allah, and they would have been martyred in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, why do I start with this story? Because in this moment of great despair, defeat, pain, and suffering, and we see that many were lost, the lives were lost in the Battle of Uhud. Muslims, Allah says in the holy verse of the Quran, لِيَبْتَلِيَ اللَّهُ مَا فِي صُدُورِكُمْ وَلِيُمَحِّصَ مَا فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ. Allah has a purpose for putting you through test. One, he wants to test your resolve, the resolve in particular that is in your chest. My dear brothers and sisters, when we suffer loss in our lives, we feel tightness in our chest. It is a very physical manifestation of our pain and our sorrow. And indeed, it is because our hearts lie in our chests. And so when Allah says that I'm going to try you, you are going to be tested as a believer. And he says, I'm going to test what you have in your chest. Is it true and is it sincere? And وَلِيُمَحْصَ مَا فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ. And Allah wants to ensure that your hearts become pure, that your hearts, no matter how much darkness falls on them over the course of years, that he gives you the opportunity to purify your heart moment after moment, especially in certain occasions of your life, certain crucial events that occur to you, they are an opportunity to purify your heart. And this, you see, was a great example in the Battle of Uhud. My dear brothers and sisters, you know that in the Battle of Uhud, one of the great shaheed, the great champions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, the religion of Allah, was Hamza ibn Abd al-Muttalib alayhi salatu wasalam, the uncle of Rasulullah. And not only was he martyred on the battle plain, on the field of Uhud, but his body had been desecrated by Hind and the Wahshi, and that his innards had been removed and his parts of his body had been cut off. His body had been desecrated. They say that when his body, when Rasul, the soldiers, the Muslims, did not want Rasulullah to see the body of his uncle. They were trying to hide the body in a manner, and so he wouldn't see and feel the pain. But eventually Rasulullah saw the body of his uncle collapsing on it, crying and weeping. And he was buried right there. But now the crucial thing, the event that takes place after this, is that on hearing what had happened in Uhud, Fatima al-Zahra alayha salatu wassalam, the beloved daughter of Rasulullah, they say she came out of Medina seeking to know the whereabouts of her father, Rasulullah. And that when she saw that her father was alive, they say she also went to the grave of her father's uncle, her own uncle Hamza, and that she took the dirt from that grave and she made a subha out of it, a rosary out of it. She took the dirt, she fashioned them into little beads, put a string around it and made a rosary out of it. My dear brothers and sisters, why do something like this? Other than to remind yourself, one, that dhikr of Allah, remembrance of Allah in every moment is crucial, but that number two, that ground, that dirt, that grave, that pit that lies in the ground, it is the home for every one of us. It is the destination for every one of us. It is where we are all going. And that is to remind us in every moment, don't be of those people who are heedless. We are born, as you all know, the Holy Quran, it says and it repeats to us that وَأَخْرَجَكُمْ مِنْ بُطُونِ أُمَّهَاتِكُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ شَيْئًا. Allah says, I took you out of the wombs of your mothers. You knew nothing. You had nothing. And he gave you your eyesight, your hearing, and your hearts, your afidah. He gave you these faculties. Why? So you can grow and thrive. In the most basic sense, when a child is born, that child is born with the innate recognition of Allah, with the innate understanding and connection to its Lord. So we ask the question that why over so many years, over 30, 40, 50, 60, 70 years, whatever God has given to us, why is it that we drift away from Allah? Why is it that we find ourselves moments in our life so far from the rope of God, so far from the path of salvation? Well, it is because although we have been born on the fitrah of Allah, the fitrah of Tawheed, the oneness of Allah is innately sort of sewn into the fabric of our natures as children. As we grow older, we develop layers and layers on top of that. We cover over that basic nature with our lifestyle, with what we do. Just the way we deal with our families, the effect of our culture, the effect of the society in which we live, does it not change our habits away from the religion of Allah, away from the obedience of Allah, such that I will find myself at moments obeying what society is telling me to do, obey what the norms of society, the mores of society are pushing me towards, rather than obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And just in doing so, I have covered over that basic nature. Now I ask you, does that basic nature disappear? That just because I have covered it over, just because I have veiled my basic nature, my love of God, my recognition of the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, just because it has disappeared underneath these layers, does that mean it ceases to exist? No, of course not. It does not cease to exist. It is in there. It is just we have to find the opportunity to remove those layers off that we tend to accumulate. It is not just the effect of society. It is not just the effect of family. It is the effect of everything we pursue in our lives. We pursue our careers. We pursue material happiness. We pursue the happiness of our children and our loved ones. And in doing so, there is nothing wrong with pursuing a career and the happiness of our children and the things that we want. But in doing so, we must not mix it or allow it to overshadow our devotion for God. And that is the thing that we all find to be a pitfall in our lives, that the driver of our life becomes everything other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the more and more we do it, the more and more that layer accumulates on top of our basic nature that God has put inside of us. Even our possessions, my dear brothers and sisters, the things that we accumulate in our lives, if we allow them to own us, we have made it so that that becomes a part of our nature. You all know that the human body physically, that the more you eat, the things you eat, it will determine the composition of your body. It will determine what type of body you have. If you eat terrible things, unhealthy things, the fat and the tissue of your body will become unhealthy. The layers that will form on your body will be unhealthy. And eventually it will come to pass where, God forbid, there will be some negative effect. Do you not think that our inner self, our intrinsic being is not the same? That the more we accumulate, the more we layer ourselves with things that cover our true spirituality, that there will be some negative ramification? Possessions are those things. Those things we acquire in our lives, material things, things we buy, things that we cannot live without, things that we have made our God and we have become subservient to rather than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They say a man, he came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. He said, Rasulullah, can I ask you a question? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, he said, yes, tell me. The man, he said, ya Rasulullah, I find that I don't love death. I don't love the encounter that I am going to have with death. I don't look forward to it. I'm afraid of it. In fact, I find myself to detest it and not feeling a welcoming feeling towards death that is certainly approaching me. Why is that? Rasulullah asked him, he says, do you have wealth and possessions? The man, he says, yes, God has blessed me with wealth and possessions. Rasulullah, he says, have you given it out to people? فَقَدَّمْتُهُ Have you given it out to others? Have you shared it with others? Have you imparted it to others such that you didn't hold on to it and clutch onto it like it's life itself for you? The man, he says, no, I have not given it to anybody. Rasulullah, he says, then how can you expect to love death and the eventuality that is facing you in front of you? You must give of those things that you possess. In the same way, our sins can be a layer that forms on top of us. Wal'ayadu billah, may Allah save us from the wiswas of the shaitan. That our sins, the more we compound, the more we compound, the harder it is to return backwards away from them. The harder it is to change yourself from the inside. That's why Al-Imam Al-Baqir alayhi salatu wassalam, our fifth imam, he says that the heart is born white. It is born full of nur. The heart of a child is pure. And yet with the accumulation of sin, when one commits a sin, a black dot forms on it. And if the person does not repent from that sin and continues to commit that sin, that black dot gets bigger and bigger and bigger until it finally envelops the entire heart, making the heart closed off to the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yet if a person repents, asks forgiveness of Allah, reforms themselves and corrects their actions, the black dot shrinks and gets smaller and nur begins to return. Why? Because again, even though the layer of darkness has formed on top, there is still opportunity to change, to reform, to cure yourself of that darkness. There is a means back. There is always a means back. And that's why even when Imam Ali alayhi salatu wasalam, he once relates from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wasallam that ya Rasulullah, how forgiving is our Lord? Rasulullah, he says, if a person asks forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and he has 1 year left in his life, Allah will forgive his sins. And then Rasulullah, he says, and 1 year is a very long time. If there is only 1 month left in his life and the person asks for forgiveness, Allah will forgive his sins. And then Rasul, he says, no, even 1 month is a long time. He says, if there is only 1 week left, then and he asks forgiveness sincerely, Allah will forgive the sins. If there's only 1 day left, that even 1 week is too much. If there is 1 day left only, and he asks for forgiveness from Allah, Allah will forgive the sin. He comes all the way down. He says, no, even 1 day is too much. If there is 1 minute left, if there is 1 second left, Allah will forgive the sins. Then Rasulullah, he stops. He says, no, even 1 second is too much. He says, إِذَا وَصَلَتِ الرُّوحَ هُنَا He says, if the ruh reaches here, and he points to his neck, if the soul is about to leave the body, The person is about to die and the soul is here in the neck, about to be pulled out, and the person asks for forgiveness of Allah. Allah will forgive. Allah will forgive. Allah is the merciful who forgives everybody. My dear brothers and sisters, we have to ensure that we believe with hope in this Lord of ours, in this God of ours. And unfortunately, much like the people in the Battle of Uhud who turned their faces away, did not understand God the way they should have understood or needed to understand, we are the ones who are short. We are the ones who are insignificant, and we are the ones who have not done what we needed to do with respect to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we allow pain and suffering and despair to enter. We sit today to remember a marhuma who, out of the sweetness of her tongue, captured the hearts of people. I remember her like she was my mother, and the smile and gentleness and love on her face always when I saw her. And I will pray for her for the rest of my life, inshallah, that it can reach to her. And yet I sit today, losing her in the manner that I lost her. And any one of you who have lost your loved ones, the Hajji who passed away, we all knew him, his relatives are feeling the pain of his departure from this world. And that emptiness that exists, that hole that exists in our hearts, that cannot be filled with anything other than Allah. Yet I ask you, that in now, in this moment, what is going to happen to us? We will despair, we will have pain, we will have sorrow, we will feel this emptiness, we will feel that Allah is not here close to us, because the thing we attached ourselves to, the hayat ad-dunya, the life of this world, has broken us somehow, has pulled something away from us. And yet Allah says, no, see with the eye that I want you to see where you are going. It is related that one day the wahi came to Dawood alayhi salatu wasalam. Nabi Dawood received the wahi. It told him that Dawood, go and visit this one individual, go to such and such a house and give this individual the good news that they are going to be in the residence or of the residence of paradise, of Jannah. Go and give them that news. Nabi Dawood, he goes to this house, he knocks on the door. A pious woman opens the door. Nabi Dawood looks at her. She recognizes him. She knows. She says, Nabi Allah Dawood, what are you doing at my house? He says to her, I have come to give you a message that I have received about you from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. She says, Nabi Dawood, definitely I am not the person you are seeking. It must be somebody else. Now she begins with humility. Automatically, she doesn't say, yes, yes, that's me. I am the one who God is talking about. No, she automatically says that I am not worthy of such a recognition by Allah. She says, no, it cannot be me. You must be seeking somebody else. Nabi Dawood, he says, no, you are the one that God has told me to come and visit. And that, take the good news that you are going to be of the residence of Jannah, of paradise. But tell me, Nabi Dawood, he says to her, that what is it that you did that made Allah so pleased with you, that has given you a place in Jannah, in the highest of places, in the permanent life of the next world? She says, I don't know. What can I tell you? She says, I am of those people who whether I am in any pain, any injury, any misfortune befalls me, any suffering befalls me or afflicts me, she says, I always exhibit patience and I never complain. And instead, I submit myself to the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if for some reason, something is taken away from me, I am deprived of something, some difficulty has come upon me, I never ask Allah to remove that difficulty. I say, Allah, this was your will to test me in this manner. Give me the patience to live through this test. I never ask the reason why this has happened or that God take this away from me. No, instead I say, Ya Allah, allow me to gracefully pass through this moment. And that is why this is the position that brings you into Jannah. My dear brothers and sisters, death is a means by which we can awaken ourselves. We can find ourselves on the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and know that finality is with Allah. That kulla shay'in fan, everything will decay and deteriorate and go except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we know that if we can see that, that permanence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that we will never feel the tremble of the life of this world. And believe me, this is what the life of this world does to you. It brings calm waters in which you live day to day, year to year, and then suddenly the turbulence hits you. Suddenly the waves begin to crash, the darkness surrounds you, and you find yourself unhinged, without an anchor, not knowing where you're supposed to go, where you thought you were going, and where you're supposed to go. And yet Allah says, see me, I am all around you. And know that I am bigger than any storm, anything that you fear. And in the dua, that my Allah is bigger, more mighty, more grand than anything I am afraid of or I am apprehensive about. It is reported that there, and I will just tell you a few stories tonight so that we can learn from those who have turned their faces to Allah, seeking from him. They say there was a man named Sa'id ibn Jubayr. Sa'id ibn Jubayr was the companion of al-Imam al-Sajjad alayhi salatu wassalam, our fourth imam. He had been persecuted by a man named al-Hajjaj ibn Yusuf al-Thaqafi. They say that Sa'id ibn Jubayr had fled away from the tyrannical regime of the Bani Umayyah in those years. We are talking about now some maybe 30, 40, 50 years after the demise of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Sa'id ibn Jubayr, this lover of the Ahl al-Bayt, had run and had fled away from the persecution and eventually had been caught by this man, al-Hajjaj ibn Yusuf al-Thaqafi, who people say was a great general, but we know was a despot and had led to the execution of many innocent individuals. Some say in the hundreds of thousands he had killed. This man, al-Hajjaj ibn Yusuf al-Thaqafi, he catches Sa'id ibn Jubayr. They bring him and he says to Sa'id ibn Jubayr, he says, Sa'id, how should I put you to death? Tell me, and I will put you to death in that manner. I grant you this. They say that Sa'id ibn Jubayr, his hands tied, he's a prisoner about to be executed. He says to al-Hajjaj, he says, however you want to kill me, you can kill me, but know that where are you going to run? In the next world, you are going to have to answer for your despotic and your evil actions. And I will get the reward for the goodness that I have done on the day of judgment. They say al-Hajjaj looks at him and patronizing him, mocking him. He says, Sa'id, I would like to pardon you. I don't want to go through this and execute you. I want to pardon you and let you go. So they say, Sa'id, he gives him a very beautiful answer. He says, Hajjaj, he says, if the forgiveness is from you, then I don't want it. If the pardoning is from you, I don't want it. But if the forgiveness is Allah's forgiveness, and the pardoning is Allah's pardoning, then I will do whatever I can to achieve and be worthy of God's forgiveness and God's pardoning. They say that Hajjaj, he orders the executioner to take Sa'id and turns his head towards the Qibla, ties his hand and tells the executioner to execute Sa'id ibn Jubayr. When he ties the hands of Sa'id ibn Jubayr, turns him to the Qibla, they say Sa'id ibn Jubayr, he recites the verse of the Holy Quran. He says, "Inni wajjahtu wajhi lilladhi fatara as-samawati wal-ard hanifan wama ana min al-mushrikeen." He says, "I have turned my face to the one who has established the skies and the earth. I am sincere in my belief of God, and I am definitely not of those who associate anyone with Allah." They say Hajjaj hears Sa'id quoting this ayah of the Quran. He becomes extremely angry. He orders the executioner. He says, turn him away from the Qibla. Turn him away from Mecca. As soon as he turns him away, almost to make him suffer, to make Sa'id suffer by turning him away from the Qibla, Sa'id ibn Jubayr, he again recites a verse of the Holy Quran. He says, فَأَيْنَمَا تُوَلُّوا فَثَمَّ وَجْهُ اللَّهِ. Anywhere that you turn, there will be the face of God in front of you. You turn to the Qibla, God's face is there in front of you. You turn to the east, God is there. You turn to the west, God is there. He gives immediately the conviction of his face. Hajjaj hears this verse being quoted by Sa'id ibn Jubayr, and he immediately says to the executioner, he says, put his head down in the ground. Push his head down towards the dirt and shove his head into the dirt. As soon as the executioner pushes Sa'id's head down towards the dirt, Sa'id says, Minha khalaqnakum wa fiha nu'idukum wa minha nukhrijukum taratan ukhra, that we have created you from this dirt. and we will return you to this dirt, and from this dirt we will raise you up on the day of judgment one more time in front of Allah. Sa'id ibn Jubayr knew where he was going, knew where he was from and where he was going. Finally, they say the executioner was announced. Sa'id ibn Jubayr, he says, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika lah, wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluh. With those words, my dear brothers and sisters, we must recognize where we are and what we are and how we are living. Even in the suffering that we undergo, we only see the pain and the negativity of the circumstances that we live in. We only see the trial. We don't see the benefit in the trial. We don't see the positive side of being in a difficult situation sometimes. And yet, the very layers that I described to you that form on the insan, the very layers that we have put upon ourselves over the 50, 60, 70 years of our life due to our habits, due to our preconceived notions, due to the effects of society, what we eat, what we believe, what we consume, how we live our lives, how we practice our faith and our worship of Allah, all of that, it can be removed off of the body. All of it can be cleared off of the body. And you all know that fasting is one of those ways. When you come to the month of Ramadan, you know that in the month of Ramadan, when you are fasting, your fast is a means by which you can shed the haram off of your body. Your fasting is an expiation. It is a means by which you remove the dirty clothes, the symbolic dirty clothes that you have taken onto your body. Your fasting is a means of purification. That's why it is good to fast throughout the year and not just in the month of Ramadan. In the same manner, charity, my dear brothers and sisters, give charity to remove the negativity from your life. Any moment you feel negativity, any moment you feel that something negative has befallen you, take out some money and give to those who are less fortunate than you are. This is a means by which we can remove the layer of negativity that forms on us, the layer that has hidden our true love of Allah and not allowed it to flourish. Finally, my dear brothers and sisters, there is one very important thing that helps us to remove those layers off of our heart and off of our body and to rediscover the true fitrah that is inside of us. They say one day it is reported that a Nabi, a prophet, some say it was Prophet Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, he was traveling somewhere in a foreign land. They say he came upon a small little village, a simple village. In the village, he saw a pious man. He knew of this pious man who lived here, very devout man, pious, worshipful, devoted to God, sincere to God. When he came in, he had asked about, they said, we haven't seen him for some days, but his house is at the end over there. You can find him. They say the prophet, maybe it was Musa, he went to the house to look for this pious man, to greet him, talk to him. He went in. When he came near the door of this pious man's home, he realized that something was not right. He knocked, no one answered. Carefully, he looked and nobody was in the house. He went in. He saw the dead body of this pious man. It was rotting away in the house. And not only was it rotting away, but it was clear that this pious man had been afflicted with a severe disease in the end days of his life and that he had suffered massively. He was sick, he was in pain, he was suffering. And what's worse, no one was near him when he died. He died all alone, suffering and in this difficult and seemingly impossible situation. In the same journey, they say that Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, he traveled and he came to another city, or the Nabi came to another city in which there was a commemoration going on. And when he asked what is happening, there were some pyres being led, there were some processions happening in the street, people were all wearing black clothes. He asked what happened. They said the king of this city or the ruler of this city has died. Now he found out that the ruler of this city was not a good man. He was an oppressive, evil human being. Definitely not of the servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But he noticed, the prophet noticed, that this ruler had the best of send-offs from this world, a grand funeral, people gathering in the streets to commemorate his funeral, to stand there and to move the body and decorations and jewels and everything to commemorate the death of this individual who was not a good human being. Short while later, they say the Prophet raises his hands and he says, Ya Allah, what is this strange thing that I have noticed? I went and I saw that pious servant of yours, the one devoted to you, sincere to you. I found him in the most pitiable of circumstances, body rotting, having suffered and died alone, and yet on the other hand, a despotic, evil human being who does not recognize you, who lives only for himself and the life of this world, and he has received the best of funerals, the most honored of sendaways from the life of this world. How is this proper, Ya Allah? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, through inspiration, answers the Prophet. He says, because I have chosen that evil person, the despotic ruler who got this beautiful, honored send-off, seemingly so, that he will pay for his actions in the next world. All the sins that he has committed in this world, he will carry them with him to the next world and answer in the grave for them. And in the next world, the honorable, the pious man, the devoted man, the servant of God who suffered in his last day, Allah tells the Prophet, he says, I wanted to make sure that when he died expiated of his sins. So for that reason, I placed great pain and suffering on him, disease and illness, such that that physical pain became a source of expiation of his sins. I washed away his sins such that when he dies and goes into the grave, that his questioning in the grave will be very light. It will not be severe like that evil despotic ruler. My dear brothers and sisters, we don't know how Allah is helping us remove those layers that have formed on our bodies, that we have imposed on ourselves in our daily lives. And what we must do is see death the way it needs to be seen. Recognize death the way it needs to be recognized, the way Allah has made it, not as this empty black place, this place of nothingness, but a place of nur, a place of light, and a place that is our permanent home, not this life of this world. Al-Imam As-Sajjad, my dear brothers and sisters, he says in one of his most poignant and beautiful du'as, and you can find this du'a in As-Sahif As-Sajjadiyya. He says, Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa alih, waqfina tool al-amal, waqassirhu anna bisidq al-amal. He says, oh Allah, may Allah's peace and blessings be upon Muhammad and the progeny of Muhammad. He says, O Allah, allow us not to rely on false extended hopes. False extended hopes. وَقَصِّرْهُ عَنَّ بِصِدْقِ الْعَمَلِ. Please ensure that our false extended hopes do not hamper our actions in the life of this world. Make us those who consciously, actively work towards achieving salvation in the next life. حَتَّى لَا نُؤَمِّلَ إِسْتِتْمَامَ سَاعَةٍ بَعْدَ سَاعَةٍ وَلَا اسْتِيْفَاءَ يَوْمٍ بَعْدَ يَوْمٍ وَلَا اتِّصَالَ نَفْسٍ بِنَفْسٍ. Make it such so that we don't have so much extended hope, false hope, that we will have 1 hour after another. Maybe the next hour we will die. Or that we will have 1 day after another. Maybe the next day we will die and leave this world. Or that we will not even have 1 breath after another breath. Make us hold on to each breath, each hour, each day as valuable so that we can work in it. وَلَا لُحُوقَ قَدَمٍ بِقَدَمٍ وَسَلِّمْنَا مِنْ غُرُورِهِ وَآمِنَّا مِنْ شُرُورِهِ. Make sure, Ya Allah, that you safeguard us from the delusion of the life of this world, and ensure that we are safe from its evil. وَانْصِبِ الْمَوْتَ بَيْنَ أَيْدِينَا نَصْبًا. O Allah, put a detailed picture of death in front of our eyes. Put a display of death that is constantly in front of our eyes. وَلَا تَجْعَلْ ذِكْرَنَا لَهُ غِبَّا. And O Allah, anytime we remember death, don't allow it to be frivolous or trivial or quickly passing. Allow us to think about death with true feeling in our heart, true recognition that it is coming to us. وَاجْعَلْ لَنَا مِنْ صَالِحِ الْأَعْمَالِ عَمَلًا. And ensure, Ya Allah, that everything that we do, every act of ours is the best of act. نَسْتَبْطِئُ مَعَهُ الْمَصِيرَ إِلَيْكَ وَنَحْرُسُ لَهُ عَلَىٰ وَشْكِ اللَّحَاقِ بِكَ. O Allah, ensure that each of our actions is conscious, and that every action has a meaning, and that every meaning has an end result that will take us towards what is best and in its eventuality towards you, hatta yakun al mautu ma'nasana alladhi na'nasu bih, O Allah, make it such that we are intimate with death, that death is intimate to us, and that we feel it to be a refuge that we seek. وَمَأْلَفَنَا الَّذِي نَشْتَاقُ إِلَيْهِ, and where we are going, that we are longing to be there in that next world. وَحَامَّتَنَا الَّتِي نُحِبُّ الدُّنُوَ مِنْهَا فَإِذَا أَوْرَدْتَهُ عَلَيْنَا وَأَنْزَلْتَهُ بِنَا فَسْعِدْنَا بِهِ زَائِرًا. O Allah, when the time comes and death takes us, make it so that we are happy to be in that moment, leaving this world towards the permanent abode. وَآنِسَنَا بِهِ قَادِمًا وَلَا تُشْقِنَا بِضِيَافَتِهِ وَلَا تُخْزِنَا بِزِيَارَتِهِ. O Allah, when death is our host and we are its guests, don't allow us to feel despise in our heart towards it. Don't allow us to feel resistance towards what it is calling us. Don't allow us to be bad guests of that host. وَاجْعَلْهُ بَابًا مِنْ أَبْوَابِ مَغْفِرَتِكَ. Make death a door of the many doors of your forgiveness, O Allah. وَمِفْتَاحًا مِنْ مَفَاتِيحِ رَحْمَتِكَ. And make it a key to the doors that will open of your mercy, Ya Allah. أَمِتْنَا مُهْتَدِينَ غَيْرَ ضَالِينَ. God, when you take us from this world, make us die guided by you and not misguided, not deluded. طَائِعِينَ غَيْرَ مُسْتَكْرِهِينَ. Obedient to you, not resistant. Ready to come to you, Ya Allah, not clutching the life of this world, hating to be torn away from it. No, Ya Allah, allow us to come to you openly. My dear brothers and sisters, we must be of these people who seek to find in Allah completion, because we are incomplete. We are weak, we are destitute, we are faqir, we are needy. And it is only in Allah that we can find completion. It is only in Allah that we can find solace and the hole that exists in our hearts, because our loved one has left us, it cannot be filled with anybody else. Nobody can replace them. It is only the love of Allah can replace. It is only the love of God that can come and take the place of that person in our lives. My dear brothers and sisters, we know this, that for a believer, that very fitrah that exists, the essence, the root of who we are, it exists and it is shaped by one person in particular. It is shaped by the mother. That mother who gives of her own self. Al-Imam As-Sajjad alayhi salatu wasalam, he says, the rights of your mother are because she has given of her soul to you. And not only, wa nafsiha laka al-wiqa, she made it such that her body was meant for you. It was built only for you, only to take care of you, that mother of yours. And so what you are is because of her. That mother is the one who we can never thank Allah enough for. That mother who we can never recognize in the way that we need to recognize. We can never thank and appreciate the way we need to appreciate that mother. And on a night like tonight, let us remember the best of mothers. Let us remember that mother who, when she saw her father lying on his deathbed, they say she came to him. And they say that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, he would say when he was in his last moments in life, surrounded by all of the people around him, he sent them all away. And he said, Aina bidhati wa nur qalbi Fatima. Where is that piece of me, Fatima? Where is she? And he would say, من عرفها فقد عرفها ومن لم يعرفها أنبأته منها إنها بضعة مني. Whoever knows Fatima, knows Fatima. And whoever does not know Fatima, Rasulullah, he says, I will tell you who she is. She is a piece of me. She is a part of my flesh. And in that moment, when Rasulullah was on his deathbed, they say Fatima al-Zahra alayha salatu wassalam, whose martyrdom and her demise from this world we are commemorating tonight, she came to the body of Rasulullah. She saw Rasulullah in his last moments. She says, Ya Aba nafsi li nafsika al-fida wa wajhi li wajhika al-waqa. Oh, my father, may my soul be sacrificed to you. Oh, my father, may my own self be sacrificed for yourself. Men lil aramili wal masakin. Oh, my father, who will take care of the widows and the poor? Men lil yatama wal fuqara. My father, who will take care of the poor after you leave? My father, who will be there for my sons, Al-Hasan and Al-Husayn, and Zainab and Umm Kulthum? My dear brothers and sisters, Rasulullah, he left this world. And the history describes that the ahzan, the sadness of Fatima at the Zahra, did not stop. You can imagine our loves for our mothers, our fathers, and what it feels like for us to lose them. Now imagine your father is the best of creation of Allah. What that loss must feel like. And the daughter is the best of daughters in Fatima at the Zahra. That in those days after the demise of Rasulullah, Fatima at the Zahra would weep for her father. And she would weep saying, Ya Allah, you have taken away the nur of this world, my father Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Yet in the very last moments of her own life, my dear brothers and sisters, we commemorate the sorrows of Ahlul Bayt. We remember the demise of Rasulullah and the loved ones of Rasulullah, Al-Imam Al-Husayn bi-Abi wa Ummi, Al-Imam Al-Hasan, all of the beloveds of Rasulullah. Why? Because we want to make our personal sorrow attached to the love of Rasulullah, to the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why we know that in those days after the demise of Rasulullah, that the difficulties upon Fatima al-Zahra were very, very great. That's why I, in the history, it is related that after the demise of Rasulullah, Fatima al-Zahra, she would say, Subbat alayya masaiba, Subbat alayya masaiba, law annaha subbat ala nahari, surna layaliya. Fatima al-Zahra, she would say, after the demise of Rasulullah, that the trials and difficulties have fallen upon me. If these same trials fell upon the daytime, that same daytime would turn dark immediately. And in the last days, they would not leave Fatima al-Zahra. Rasulullah would say about her, Man adaha faqad adani. Whoever harms her, causes her pain, causes me pain. They came to the door of Fatima al-Zahra with their schemes and their plans in those days, not leaving the door of Fatima. Inna kasr al-dhil'i laysa yanjabir illa bisumsam aziz muqtadir. قال سليم قلت يا سلمان هل دخلوا ولم يكن استئذان قال اي وعزة الجبار دخلوا على الزهراء بغير خمار. They came to the door of Fatima al-Zahra. They came to the door of the daughter of Rasulullah. The history, it says, they demanded that the door be open. They demanded that if the door was not open, that they will burn the house and light fire to the house. Fatima al-Zahra, she would not open the door. Suddenly the man, he came.
He began to kick on the door. He began to push on the door with his leg. He began to push the door open. A lady is inside of her house. A strange man comes to the door, pushing the door on the daughter of Rasulullah. Where will she hide inside the house? What is her recourse in that moment? She hides behind the door to hide herself from the eyes of the stranger looking upon her. فَعَصَرُوهَا عَصَرَا وَعَصَرُوهَا بَيْنَ الْبَابِ وَالْجِدَارِ حَتَّى نَبَتَ الْمِسْمَارُ فِي صَدْرِهَا وَسَالَتِ الدَّامِ. They say that he kept pushing the door, squeezing and crushing her between the door and the wall. They crushed Fatima Zahra in between the door and the wall. حتى سقط محسنا على عتبة الباب. The unborn child in her womb died and was aborted. The child, the son who was to be named Muhsin. What is the plight of Fatima Zahra? Only a few days to live after this event. يلباب أنا لبست الحزن طول الدهر والله يلباب هي لولا بقال فكر والله يلباب نشدك وين محسن صغر والله يلبام 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 يوم اللي عصره والزهرة الزكية يوم اللي عصره الزهرة الزكية إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون وسيعلم الذين ظلموا على محمد أي منقلب ينقلبون والعاقبة للمتقين. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. اللهم إنا نسألك وندعوك ونقسم عليك بحق الزهراء وأبيها وبعلها وبنيها والسر المستودع فيها لعن الله ظالميها. اللهم شافي كل مريض، اللهم رد كل غريب، اللهم فك كل أسير، اللهم غير سوء حالنا بحسن حالك يا كريم. اللهم وفقنا لمراضيك وجنبنا معاصيك وثبت أقدامنا على صراطك المستقيم وخذ بأيدينا إليك يا أرحم الراحمين وفرج عنا يا الله فرجا عاجلا قريبا كلمح البصر أو هو أقرب من ذلك وافرغ علينا صبرا وتوفنا مسلمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وآله الطيبين الطاهرين. آه يا فاطمة
صل على محمد وآل محمد يا زهراء يا حسين يا حسين يا حسين يا حسين يا حسين
يا حسين
يا حسين
ما درد جهان فاطمه جان دل بتو بستیم محبان تو استیم ما درد جهان فاطمه جان دل بتو بستیم محبان تو هستیم نظر کن ز عنایت بفردای قیامت ای شاه عرب نیمه شب جسم من زار بر خاک تو بسپار نبینی رخ نیلی تو از ضربت سلی در معرکه عشق تو ما مرد جنونیم همه فاطمیونیم بدنبال شهادت فدای ولایت ما در دو جهان فاطمه جان دل به تو بستیم محبان تو هستیم در عشق علی سینه سپر تا دم آخر تو هی حافظ حیدر در عشق علی سینه سپر تا دم آخر تو هی حافظ حیدر خروش تو در این راه علیان ولی الله ما در دو جهان فاطمه جان دل به تو بستیم محبان تو هستیم دست همه بر چادر تو در صف محشر به قربان تو مادر دست همه بر چادر تو در صف محشر به قربان تو مادر اگر تو بشکستیم به امید تو هستیم مادر دو جهان فاطمه جان دل به تو بستیم محبان تو هستیم ای روح علی جان نبی ام ابیها تو هی حضرت زهرا ای روح علی جان نبی ام ابیها تو هی حضرت زهرا فدای تو پیامبر با قربان تو حیدر مادر دو جهان فاطمه جان دل به تو بستیم محبان تو هستیم ای راضیه و مرضیه و کوثر و طه تو هی عصمت کبرا ای راضیه و مرضیه و کوثر و طه تو هی عصمت کبرا پناه همه عالم تو هی فاطمه جانم ای فاطمه جان جان دی جان دل به تو بستیم محبان تو هستیم ماهیم فدای حرم زینب کبرا با فرمان تو زهرا ماهیم فدای حرم زینب کبرا با فرمان تو زهرا همه بنده عشقیم نگهبان دمشقیم مادر دو جهان فاطمه جان دل به تو بستیم محبان تو هستیم نظر کن ز عنایت به فردای قیامت یا حسین
يا حسين يا حسين يا حسين يا حسين